Hello friends, welcome to Pioneer of Success, an online free educational institute. So we are continuing with the chemistry series and today we will be discussing on atomic structure. So this is the part 3 video of atomic structure. We have already uploaded 2 videos on atomic structure. If you haven't seen them yet, you can have a look. You go to my channel and then click on playlists. In playlist, you will have an option chemistry series. In that chemistry series, you will get all the videos related to chemistry. So this video is basically helpful for WBJEE, JEE mains, medical entrance aspirants, and as well as for WBCS mains chemistry. And also if you are preparing for your college chemistry, then it would be helpful for you. So let us move forward. Before going into details, let me tell you something about myself. Yeah. I am Shishyendu Mitra, a research scholar of Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati, and here is the faculty in Pioneer of Success, and those are my email IDs. If you have any queries, you can write me email. So now let us carry forward. So atomic structure comprehensive, this is the name of the lecture. So here we will be studying properties of light, spectroscopy, quantum hypothesis, hydrogen atom, Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which we have already covered, but we will be repeating once again, and orbitals. So all these things will be covered here. So before starting, let me tell you something about electromagnetic radiation. Now what is electromagnetic radiation? From the term itself, you can have a look to the terminology. So there is electro term and magnetic term. Combinedly, they are called electromagnetic radiation. That means there is something related to electric field and related to magnetic field as well. So electromagnetic wave basically generates when two fields oscillates situating mutually perpendicular to each other. That means suppose you have a electromagnetic wave, or electromagnetic, you have an electric field say in the xy plane, then you should have a magnetic field in the plane perpendicular to xy, say your yz plane. Okay, so if these two fields resides in two planes perpendicular to each other and oscillates, then it generates a wave. That wave is called your electromagnetic wave. So for the time being, this is enough regarding electromagnetic wave. So I'm moving forward. So we'll be discussing on subatomic particles. By the time you all know, electron, proton, all those things are subatomic particles, because an atom is consisting of these particles. And one more thing, we have two theories on electron. Electron is considered as particle as well as wave. Sometimes we consider electron as particle and sometimes as wave. So what are the reasons behind, we'll be discussing as we carry forward. Light is an example of electromagnetic radiation. Here you see the term crossed electric and magnetic waves. We'll be coming to it later. Okay, what I was talking, this is the example. Say this is the electric field and this is the magnetic field. So this is the electric field, yeah, and this is the magnetic field, see. And this is alternating. What does it mean? Initially it was the electric field, now in this direction this is the electric field, and perpendicular to that, say this is in the plane outward to the plane of the computer, and this is in the plane of the computer for say. So those are mutually perpendicular and they are oscillating, and it is generating an electromagnetic wave. So few more things about electromagnetic wave. Electromagnetic wave has wavelength, frequency, amplitude. Now what is wavelength? Wavelength means distance between same alternatives. What does it mean? See, it is repeating this wave. That means it is going down, again coming up, again going down, coming up. So this is the entire thing is repetition of this thing. So this much distance is called your wavelength. Now you have frequency. Frequency means your, I already told you there is a relation, that is C equal to nu lambda. Now C is known for all electromagnetic wave. C is constant, that is the velocity of electromagnetic wave, and it is considered 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. That is the velocity of light also, because light is also an electromagnetic wave. So C equal to nu, if you know C, if you know lambda, you can easily calculate frequency. Okay, another thing is there, that is called nu bar or wave number. It is denoted by 1 by lambda, and the significance is that in a particular unit length, suppose this is the unit length, how many wavelengths are there, how many, that means this much distance, how many are there, that is called your wave number. So this is very important from the point of view of spectroscopy. We will be discussing it later. So again, moving forward, so this is the form of electromagnetic wave I have shown you. This is your transverse wave, so visible light I have taken into account. This is the visible wavelength of the visible light, and your wavelength is this much, amplitude is this much. In this case, this is the amplitude, and this is called node. So those terms, those terminologies you should know. Okay, so frequency is generally denoted by Greek letter nu, and wavelength is denoted by Greek letter lambda. This is the common convention. And the units, frequency has a unit of hertz, that means cycles per second, and wavelength is a unit of distance. We denote it sometimes by micrometer, sometimes by nanometer, and like that. All radiation has this relation I have already mentioned, C equal to nu lambda. If you know the velocity of light, then you can calculate other properties. Suppose velocity is known, this one is known, and this one is known. So we can calculate this one. Again, this one is known, and this one is known. We can calculate this one. This is a constant, so all the time we will be knowing this. Okay, so now one thing you can understand from here, suppose C equal to nu lambda. So nu can be written as C by lambda. So it has a opposite relationship, that means inverse relationship. So if your lambda increases, then your nu would go down, and the vice versa. And that is what I have written here: long wavelength, small frequency; short wavelength, high frequency. And here this is the visible spectrum. You can understand from here, visible spectrum has wavelength from 400 nanometer to say 750 or 780 nanometer, and the wavelength of red light is the maximum, and the wavelength of blue light is the minimum. So all these things you should know. One simple example I have given, say red light has wavelength of 700 nanometer, it is given, calculate the frequency. You know the simple relation, you equal to C by lambda. You put the velocity of light here, that is 3 into 10 to the 8 meter per second, and your lambda 7 into 10 to the minus 7 meter, because it was in nanometer, I have converted it to meter. So it is coming around 4.29 into 10 to the 14 hertz. Okay, wave nature of light is shown by classical wave properties such as interference and diffraction. So what does it mean? It means a particle cannot give these things, interference or diffraction. And as light is showing these two properties, so this is a wave. So, okay, now the concept of quantum mechanics came by Max Planck, and it was around 1858 that was the birth age of Max Planck. So around 90s you have quantum mechanics, and in quantum mechanics what is there, that means according to quantum mechanics, I have already told, the shells or energy levels are quantized. What does it mean? Suppose this is n equal to 1, principal quantum number, this is n equal to 2. It is saying that only n equal to 1 and n equal to 2 is possible, that is integer values. No energy states in between is possible. So electron can only reside here, 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 but no way it would be residing somewhere between these two energy states. Okay. So okay, so Planck hypothesis is saying an object can only gain or lose energy by absorbing or emitting radiant energy in quanta. In quanta means you have specific energy level and it will release that much amount or it would absorb that much amount. That is called quanta, or energy is quantized. So I'll discuss in detail. So you have a relationship from the point of view of quantum mechanics, that is energy equal to h into nu, where h is a Planck constant and nu is the frequency of the wave. The value of the Planck constant you should know, and this it is given here. Okay, so light with a large lambda has small e, because you can understand from this relationship, if e equal to h nu, then in if I convert it, it would be E equal to Hc by lambda. So from here you can see if lambda is higher, your energy is lower, and the vice versa. That is what I have shown here. Now I am coming to photoelectric effect. Now what photoelectric effect is saying, that was invented by Albert Einstein, and he got Nobel Prize because of this photoelectric effect. And the photoelectric effect demonstrates the particle nature of light. So we'll be discussing photoelectric effect in detail in a separate video, but for the time being you can understand there is a effect. Suppose you have a sodium or some metal plate, and photon, that is light, is coming incidenting on that plate, and after certain energy level, that means if you put a light of certain wavelength or having certain minimum energy, it would start ejecting electrons from the metal, and that phenomenon is called your photoelectric effect. So we'll be discussing it in detail. So classical theory says that E of ejected electron should increase with increase in light intensity not observed. What does it mean? It is saying that if we keep the lambda of the light constant and only increase the intensity, then there will be no effect on number of electrons ejecting by photoelectric effect. It is only the energy of the photon, that is the wavelength or frequency of the wave, that would affect the emission of electron. That means if you increase the frequency, that means if you increase the energy, then it would give you more electrons. But if you do not increase the frequency, only increase the intensity, then it would not affect on the okay. So now I'm coming to energy radiation, and the problem is simple problem. Calculate the energy of 1 mole of photons of red light. So how can you do it? You have a relation E equal to h nu, that is for 1 mole. So for n mole you have the relationship E equal to n h nu. So n is known, n is 1 mole, h is known, and nu is also known. So from there you can calculate energy. So all these things are known, you can multiply and have E. So I have done it here, I'll show you. Yeah. But this is the value of h. I have taken nu, n equal to 1 is not shown here, nu is given, I have put it, and I got this much energy. Okay, now I am coming to atomic spectra. I have discussed it earlier. Say there is a nucleus and there are shells k equal to k l, that is n equal to 1 2 3 4. Now electron in hydrogen resides here, but if you put energy, it can go here, it can go here, all the possible energy states it can go. But after that, if you relax it, then electron would again come back to lower energy states, and when it comes back, then it emits energy and in the form of wave, that is called your spectrum. So Bohr's greatest contribution is on the spectra. So line spectra of excited atoms, why do they give spectra? I have already mentioned. So this is the hydrogen spectra, you can have a look. It is shown in the visible range, 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer. This is for mercury, this is for neon. And what is it showing? Whatever lights we see in malls and other places, those are neon light, neon spectra. Okay, so now I'll be coming to Bohr model and atomic spectra. I have already mentioned, say they have shown here two orbits, and electrons are residing here. In the first orbit you can have only two electrons, and here in the valence shell say there is only one electron. Now classically any orbit should be possible, and so is any energy. What does it mean? Basically n can have a value from 1 to infinite. What does it mean? You can have many shells or orbits, but in reality you can have hardly 6 or 7 orbits for heavy metal, because you have only around 115 elements. So you have only 115 electrons, so for that you need only 6 or 7 orbits. So beyond that it is not possible, but theoretically after that also 8, 9, 10 up to infinite it is possible, and so the energy states. But a charged particle moving in an electric field should emit energy. Okay, so now I am coming to atomic spectra. I will tell you in details, and we will be dealing with quantum mechanics or wave mechanics. And I have already mentioned so many times, it can only exist in certain discrete orbits, and that is called stationary states. It is restricted to quantized energy state. I have already mentioned all these things. Okay, so for that energy state, we have calculated that energy state is in the form of minus C by N square. If you see my video where I have discussed how to calculate radius of Bohr orbit and energy of Bohr orbit, there I have shown you the energy is in the form of this. It was coming in the form of like 2 pi square a meter therefore by n square a square, like that form is there. So from there I have shown directly by minus C by n square, where C is a constant and n is the quantum numbers, n 1 2 2 2 3. Now energy of quantized state is minus C by n square, where n is the quantum number, principal quantum number, only integer values are permitted. Radius of allowed orbital is n square into 0.0529 nanometer. If you can remember, I have shown it in video on radius calculation, and there if you remember I have shown this is 0.529 angstrom, and 0.529 angstrom means 0.0529 nanometer. So if you want to calculate radius, the first radius is 0.529 angstrom or 0.0529 nanometer, and second would be multiplied by n square, that means 2 square multiplied by this value, 3 square for the third multiplied by this value, and so on. So if you know the first radius, you can calculate the other radius. Okay, so now I have shown two energy states, n equal to 1 and n equal to 2. For n equal to 1 you have C by n square, that means C by 1 square. For n equal to 2 you have C by 2 square. So now we will calculate the difference of energy delta E, and it will be equated to h nu from the quantum mechanical point of view. So this is the difference, if E final by E initial. So minus C 1 by 1 square minus 1 by 2 square, it is coming around 3 by 4 C, and I would equate it to h nu in order to calculate your. Okay, before equating it to h nu, I'll tell you one thing. C has been found from experiment, but nowadays it is called Rydberg constant, and this is a constant value equal to R, and it has a value of this much. That means R equal to 1312 kilojoule per mole, or 3.29 into 10 to the power 515 hertz. Okay, so if it is in energy, it has this value, and if it is in frequency or wave number, then you have this value. Okay, so E is emitted light, and it has a value of 3 by 4 C, that means 3 by 4 R. Now you put the value of R in hertz, then you have this value. So from there you can calculate lambda of the light also, because lambda is equal to C by nu. So you know nu, you put the nu, you know C. The here C means light, velocity of light. Okay, so one thing you should always remember, you have so many spectra of hydrogen atom. I have already shown the Lyman series, Balmer series, Persian series, Brackett series, Phoon series. But out of this all series, you have only one series which would be in the range of visible light, and that is Balmer series. Okay, that is why it is important, and that may be a MCQ question also. So those are the energy states. One more thing, see, distance between the first two energy states is not equal to the distance between other energy states, because it is varying by 1 by n square, and 1 by n square is not equal for, if you put 1, 2, 3, that means if you put 1, it is coming 1, if you put 2, it is coming 1 by 4, then coming 1 by 9. So as it is moving forward, the difference is diminishing, and so you can see here from the image, here it is the minimum and here it is the maximum. It is because of this fact. Okay, so E already we know, C by n square, the value of C has been put, C or R, whatever you say. Here we have shown 6 orbits, n equal to 1 2 3 4 5 and 6. 2 is shown in green, and it means Balmer series. When electron comes back to 2, that means in ground state it is residing here, the electron. In excited state it can go to any orbital. Say it can go here, say it can go here, say it can go here. Now from there, if it comes back to energy state, second energy state, then it is called Balmer series. Okay. It would be calling Balmer alpha, Balmer beta, Balmer gamma, and so on, Balmer delta, like that. But all are Balmer line only. Okay. So first, if electrons are coming back in the first energy state, it is called Lyman series, and it is in the domain of ultraviolet. And the second one is Balmer, it is in the domain of visible, and then it is called Persian series. Okay, so Bohr model and quantum mechanics, we have already studying with the help of quantum mechanics, the Bohr model. Then we are going to wave mechanics, and basically this guy, he has told that electron has dual nature, that is it can behave as a particle at a wave, and he has given a relation where we can actually correlate this, and this is given by h nu equal to hc by lambda. That means energy of the light, and from the quantum mechanics and classical mechanics he equated, and from there we can calculate the things by making wave particle duality. Again, there is one other relation of Einstein where his mass and energy is interconvertible, and the equation is E equal to mc square. By putting all this, we are calculating mc equal to h by lambda. Okay, so lambda for particle is called the de Broglie wavelength. Here, calculating from these equations, if you calculate lambda from this equation, we will be calling it de Broglie wavelength. Okay, so wave properties of matter. So these things we will be discussing in a separate video. Today up to that, and I hope you liked this video. If you like it, kindly share it on social media. And also, if you have any queries, you can write me an email. I'll be happy to reply to your email. Ask questions in the below comment section, and I'll be happy to make more videos. If you like my video, if you share it, and thank you very much.